you very much. And I will be finishing positively by 11 o'clock. I was told that it has to be half an hour speech. So I will finish it by then. Well, I was impressed with the questions which Professor Sajdeva raised as an anthropologist. And I personally believe that interdisciplinary researches are all right and we must encourage them. But at the same time, we should remain on our steady feet. The anthropological lessons we have, we should not forget them. And what I would be doing in this presentation of mine, I would only be placing before you some of the central ideas I have learned by teaching medical anthropology for many years and also by contributing to medical anthropology, you know, by way of research and also supervising a number of dissertations on that. The first anthropological lesson which I have learned is that these concepts like mental health and well-being, these are value-loaded concepts. These concepts are culturally contextual and they have to be understood in that particular context. And therefore the problem of generalization comes up, which I will take up as I proceed. Further, I would like to place before you that these days a lot of narrative is being generated about COVID-19, about the changes which are coming in the society. And we are reading a lot on mental health problems, and also a large number of methods are being proposed to combat, you know, the problems which come, which I will call some kind of panacea recipes. Are there, this is what is to be done, that is to be done. And we start questioning the veracity of these methods, the truthfulness of these methods, and also their fruitfulness, how fruitful these methods are. And so we have come to a stage where we find very difficult to generalize. And I want to draw your kind attention to this whole question of generalization, particularly in the context of Indian society, which has a lot of diversity, which has a lot of strata, and each strata has different issues. And thus, lockdown has affected people differently. And the families have responded in a different way. While studying Indian society, we cannot ignore class and ethnicity. And the impact of all these things has been differential in these communities. And I, you know, being in the midst of these things and also working in the Anthropological Survey of India, you know, where we come out with a newsletter every 3 months. And this newsletter, in which we report the kind of activities we carry out, in the present newsletter, we don't have many activities to report because of the lockdown. The office was not able to work. We were not able to carry out the kind of researches we do. So we thought of coming out with a volume of our newsletter on the experiences of different faculty members, our scientific staff, which is called scientific staff, to lockdown, to kind of experiences they have. And I'm reading each one of them and also understanding them in terms of the content analysis, the method of content analysis. Now, I find that someone who happens to be from Manipur is having a different kind of an experience with respect to someone who comes from the state of Odisha. So you see the variation in that. For example, a person who is from Manipur and is working in our survey, she writes that how her family members living in Delhi had to face the after effects of stigma, how people looked at them and passed words or hurled abuses at them. And one thing which really touched me was that her mother from Manipur rang her up and said that you must cover your face when you go out of the house, because number one, you will be able to protect yourself or other against all kinds of infections, and also people will not be able to identify who you are. So what I'm trying to say is that these experiences are very different, and therefore generalization becomes very difficult. I just give you one example. We are talking a lot about domestic violence, and I have read a lot on this, the kind of reportings which come. And we try to give some kind of explanations. For example, one of the explanations which comes is that men are always home. The men were not home. You know, this is the typical distinction which anthropologists have made between the domestic realm and the rural realm. You know, the distinction goes back to the British social anthropology, that women are supposed to be taking care of the household, the domestic realm, and men are outside. And when the reverse is to happen, in the sense that men come home, women continue to stay there, and there are likely to be some kind of conflicts, some kind of scrimmages which are bound to be there. Then men have lost their job, the tension which comes because of this, or men are demanding a lot, right, from example, you know, good food to, you know, the carnal pleasures. So all kinds of things have come, and they are creating a situation in which domestic violence is going to come. Now, my immediate response to these kinds of things is that in anthropology, we must make a distinction between what is called received knowledge and what is called generated knowledge. Received knowledge is what you get from outside, from your reading, whatever is available in the context, and on the basis of this you carry out your own study. Sometimes, you know, while teaching I use the word that the first approach is funnel down approach, the second approach is funnel up approach, and I call it funnel up approach because you start with a particular case, you study it, and then on the basis of that case you try to arrive at certain propositions which may be subjected to testing. Now, this is the method which we adopt. And as you know, that these days we are debating a lot on the kind of methodology we are going to use in the COVID times, because our traditional way of conducting face-to-face fieldwork is under stress. We can't carry it out. And especially at the Anthropological Survey of India, where we are carrying out the studies of the denotified communities, and so many teams, you know, they have come back just because they can't go and carry out the fieldwork. What kind of an alternative we can think of? And I find this debate really interesting, starting from, for example, Daniel Miller's, you know, idea of digital ethnography to what is called patchwork research, patchwork fieldwork. We have a whole spectrum of these things. And I find these debates very interesting. And they are, in fact, contributing to the methodological strength of the discipline. I think we should never leave out the issues of methodology, because we have to keep in mind that each community defines itself in the context of its culture. So the problem of the migrants is very different from the problems of the middle classes. Actually, you know, in the earlier presentation we had here, the seminar we had, you know, I tried to make it very clear that most of the writings which we are reading, most of the writing with which we are aware of most of the writings which are in the newspaper, they are from the vantage point of the middle classes, or the upper middle classes. We do not know what is happening in the tribal villages. We do not know what is happening in the tribal household. Someone used the word that these people are more concerned about, under quote, hunger virus than coronavirus. Now, these are important issues, and therefore they would require a first-hand study of the situation. And therefore, my second submission is that we must shed off this middle-class scholarship, the middle-class bias. You know, what is happening in my household is not happening in the household of the denotified community person who is struggling with everything, who doesn't have money to buy a face mask. On the other end, you know, I go to the market and buy hundreds of these face masks which suit my dresses. So you know how the face mask industry has really come up. My third submission is, and therefore I will go back to the point and say that we have to look at the reality of the family, what is happening in the family. And I always believe, and something which I have always said, that we must start with a study of our family. You know, in my family, for example, I have the greatest asset, because whenever I have to give any seminar, I discuss it with my wife. Although my wife is in Delhi and I'm in Calcutta, I discuss with her. The kind of intellectual partnership we have is very different from the kind of partnership which may be happening in the other household. And therefore, we have to keep in mind the reality of the family, reality of the family who are together, reality of the household, whether it is one person household or it is a joint household. My third submission is that as I said in the beginning, that there is a catalog of problems with which we are concerned. In fact, as I see, and this is something I have learned not only from the writings of W.H.R. Rivers, but also from a man who started as a psychiatrist, later on turned to anthropology, Arthur Kleinman. So when you look at this, you find that these terms, mental illness, well-being, they are canopy terms. They are umbrella terms. They include a large number of things in it. I don't know what you mean by when you say mental health or mental problem, because if my understanding is right, it would include dementia, it would include depression, anxiety, it would include all kinds of psychopathological reactions, it would include truancy, it would include substance abuse, this would include school failures, this would include violence, this would include a large number of things, and top of this, you know, the loneliness. Now, proceeding from this, that how, you know, the category of mental health is, and something which has to be studied contextually. I personally give the first importance to fieldwork. Go and find out what are the mental issues there. And this is something on which I have written a lot earlier also, that what may be regarded as a medical problem in our context may not be so in another context. And as a footnote, I would like to refer to you the whole concept of medicalization of society, which I think all medical anthropologists know. And for those who do not know, that something which is a social problem is understood as a medical problem. Say, for instance, your child is not able to pick up words when the child is, say, 1.5 years old or 2 years old, you immediately consult the doctor, rather than giving the chance to the nature to heal, rather than looking at the differential cultural factors which may be responsible for this. So some kind of a refuge category comes, go to the doctor and the solution will come. My child is not able to study, the doctor will find a solution. I have bad dream, the doctor will find a solution, rather than looking inwardly. In fact, I sometimes tell jokingly, you know, my colleague, that these days, even if you have a toothache, you suffer and try to look for other kinds of alternative treatment, because no hospital is going to entertain you. So you have to take care of your health. And I personally think that this is a kind of individualization which has occurred, which in long way will make us far more empowered than we were earlier, far more empowered in terms of our thinking, and far more empowered in terms of looking at our own own thinking, which can really help. What is this happening? Hello. Yeah. So now the question comes that what kind of a scenario in this? And I am gradually coming to funneling down to what I have to say. What kind of a scenario is this? Let me describe it in just one word, which may not exist in your dictionary. It is called unknownness. A state of unknownness. We do not know what it is. Look at, if you look at the discourses which come from the state, which come from the WHO, you find shifting grounds. What these institutions say in the beginning, what they are saying later are two different things, whether it is a face mask or about the symptom. This morning I read in the Indian Express that now new kinds of guidelines have come, which in addition to the person-to-person contact, the fomite transmission of the virus, it also refers to the airborneness of the virus. New things come. I also read in some of the newspaper that there is a lot of debate about the HCQ, the medicine which has come, and two doctors from All India Institute of Medical Sciences have written to British Journal that challenging the efficacy of this thing, and also emphasizing how this would be useful. So looking at the challenge and looking at the usefulness, what I am submitting for your perusal is that as the cases are spiraling, as the cases are increasing. And this morning I read that India has 11,18,107 cases, although the mortality rate has reduced to 2.45. Now, this is an encouraging thing. When you read at these things, the cases are increasing, and it is affecting all equally. Now, just look at the kind of responses which come in the newspaper when Mr. Amitabh Bachchan and his family, they are diagnosed positive. The kind of responses which come. And I was immediately reminded of the statement of Mike Ryan, who was the health advisor to WHO, and who said that this was many months ago. He said that corona makes no distinction, and if you allow me to use a phrase from Max Weber, corona has no soul. It does not make a distinction between rich and the poor, between ethnicity, between gender, and he says that it may affect you, notwithstanding the fact the amount of money you have in your bank. And the same thing was said by the legendary singer Lata Mangeshkar, referring to Amitabh Bachchan, that this does not make a distinction between one person and the other, a kind of leveling effect, a kind of equalization. But immediately when I read this, I just thought that whether stigma affects all of us equally. I entirely agree with this book, which was written by Margaret Locke, Vinadas. Vinadas was first, Margaret Locke, and Arthur Kleinman, which was titled Social Suffering. And one of the major points this book made was that social suffering is not always illness. They may overlap. There may be substantial overlapping, or they may exist separately. I was immediately reminded of this, because this book also suggests, and this is a very valid point and can be taken up for further elaboration, for further understanding. We have to go beyond the concept of stigma. Now, this is the point. Go beyond it. And when you go beyond the concept of stigma, then you have to look at the process which leads to exclusion, the process which leads to discrimination. You have to go beyond it, because the kind of a stigma which comes when a man like Mr. Amitabh Bachchan falls ill, or when a poor person living in a lower class neighborhood falls ill, the responses are very different. And it was pointed out by many people, including the director of the All India Institute of Medical Sciences, that people hide their symptom. They conceal their state of mind because they know the kind of consequences which are going to come in case, God forbid, in case they are diagnosed positive. What would happen to the family? What would happen to the household? And I have spoken to a large number of people because I made use of the telephonic method of collecting data. And I've spoken to a number of people. I've in fact kept an account of what is happening to them on a day-to-day basis. One of my colleagues' wife fell ill as she was diagnosed with fever. Right from the first day till today, I'm following it. I would call it extended case study method. And incidentally, you know, Max Gluckman gave this, and F.G. Bailey, you know, who was a product of what is sometimes called the Manchester School of Anthropology, he died recently. So this method is very useful. And while I'm talking to them, I'll talk about these things when I speak on 29th on methodology. When I'm talking to them, I'm continuously taking notes. I'm not recording because I believe that if I have to record, I must seek their permission. I'm noting down whatever they are seeing. And that is why I'm trying to build up my reservoir of data. So you will find that you have to go beyond the concept of stigma. Look at the process which helps in this kind of a thing and how this affects different communities differently. And thus the responses of different classes would be very different. Now, there are a large number of aspects which have been pointed out, right from depression to anxiety to what would happen next. Huh? Say, for example, about examination. I mean, you can't understand those who are in the university and those who have children studying in the university, like I have one child who's studying in the university. You can imagine the kind of worry they have because the institutions are uncertain. The institutions are not telling us what is to be done. It's a state of the limbo when you're neither here nor there. Tell them the exams will take place on this day and go ahead. Or tell them that exams will not take place. You know, some kind of a thing has to come. Now look at how liminality increases anxiety. Now this is an important hypothesis which needs to be tested. How liminality, when you are neither here nor there, how it creates. Now, you have a whole spectrum of problems, which I'm sure, you know, after me, a large number of people are going to talk about this, from depression to anxiety to drug abuse, to failures, to all that kind of thing, domestic violence and other things. We look for, in an anthropological analysis, we look for what is the key concept of all this, what is the key concept in that particular situation? Why is there depression? Why is there the feeling of lowliness? Why are we having this? Well, social suffering, as Locke, Das, and Kleinman argue, the social suffering is a part of the social structure. Pain is a part of the social structure. And please do not think that sometimes we are in a state of non-suffering, at another time we are in a state of suffering. That's not really, really true. There is some kind of a spectrum of suffering, and we are placed somewhere on this spectrum. Now, look at the context in which this is happening. I personally think, and this is based on whatever little work I have done and whatever little understanding I have. I was deeply impressed by the work of George Foster when I read his book with Barbara Anderson on medical anthropology. When I started teaching this course way back in the 1990s, I was trained in medical anthropology by the famous Gilbert Lewis, who had worked on leprosy in the Papua New Guinea. So when I read this, you know, one idea which comes in Foster and Anderson's book is that why the psychological problem, behavioral problem, the cases of possession, the cases of anorexia, the cases of dejection, why these cases come in the context of simple societies, why these shamans are such an important person in the societies, why it is so, and why we look for some kind of a reductionist explanation. This is all because of the entry of a spirit, some kind of a nefarious spirit in the individual. And the answer given by Foster and Anderson was, it is because their cosmology, the cosmology of these communities is having very punitive spirits, dangerous spirits. And they demand complete adherence. The moment you violate that kind of an adherence, that kind of a rule, that kind of a more of working according to the demands of the spirit or the defiance of the power, you are bound to be affected. In fact, building upon this, David Mandelbaum made a distinction between pragmatic deities and transcendental deities. And he said that the pragmatic deities, which outnumber in the case of simple communities, these pragmatic deities, they demand a lot of adherence from you. They want everything to be followed. They are not at all pardoning. They make you suffer. Now, in this kind of a cosmology, where this is the environment you have, the environment of which I would once again say, unknownness. You do not know where that nefarious spirit would be living. You go out in the evening, in the night, to relieve yourself. And you come home with fever and you find all kinds of nightmares and the spirit has come on you. You didn't know that the spirit was there. This kind of unknownness, what it arouses, and for me, this is the key concept right now, is a very simple concept called fear. This is what is the basic concept, the fear. I will not, because I only have 5 minutes at my disposal, I will not go into the definition, the ontology and epistemology of fear, what it is. But fear, if you start analyzing, has content, it has ends, it has causes, it has responses. That is how I have tried to analyze it. And when you come to content, you find it can be at the individual level. I enter into my house and I find that it is dark and I am suddenly possessed with the idea that there may be something unknown, or there may be fear of lizards, or it can be collective fear. But at the same time, fear is also a result of the institutional complex. We can call it institutional fear, where the fear is an outcome of the rules, where fear is an outcome of the cosmology, where fear is an outcome of the situations which are around you, and where, you know, the consequences are going to be dangerous. Now, is there any support to this idea that there is something called fear and there's something which causes, and we are all suffering from one or the other kind of fear, whether you acknowledge it or you don't acknowledge it, the fear that tomorrow you may fall ill, the fear that tomorrow you may be quarantined. And I know it. I came to Calcutta and I was advised by the police that I must be quarantined for 14 days. And then I was told that for 5 days and then for another 4 days, you must watch your symptom. And I cannot tell you, I have described it in my own diary, the kind of fear I had each day. Even if I cleared my throat, or even if I got up with the clogged nose, which is quite common, or when I had a little warmth in my body because of the humidity, my mind went to the category called COVID, that it could be, you know, some kind of a reductionist type of a thing. Is there a substance to this? And I would draw upon a number of anthropological writing which look at the fear. And one of the first one, which is by Walter Cannon. It was a study of the Haitis. It was a study of the voodoo magic. And what Walter Cannon said, and this was really very interesting. Look at the historical context. You cannot ignore that. The historical context of the Haitians, the kind of problem they had in 1937, when almost 15,000 of the Haitians were done to death. Now, these kinds of experiences which are built up, today we say they become a part of the collective memory of people. How these factors affect it and how it creates a kind of fear, whether it is the fear of, whether it is the fear of the unknown or the fear of the powerful people. So among the Haitians, when the shaman points his bone towards you, you feel that the voodoo magic is going to come on you and you're going to suffer. So you are living in an environment like this, and I have been greatly benefited reading again the work of Walter Cannon, and also reading a lot of literature on the culture of fear, on the anatomy of fear, and how does fear affect a particular system, how fear, you know, leads to a situation where we feel completely dejected and there is no one to help you. I believe that this time has created a lot of individualization. You have to take care of your own health. You have to take care of your own self. And you know that in case something happens, no one will be able to help you. Now, bereavement, for example. Now, this is other interest which I have developed. Now, I've always been interested in working on the rights of the dead. Look at the bereavement. So suppose tomorrow, if I die of COVID-19, God forbid, if I die, then I would be buried or cremated, depending upon the religious affiliation to which I belong, you know, in the company of the health workers. My family members will not be there to see me. It's a very sad scenario, and this is inside all of us. Now, finally, against this backdrop, what kind of a lesson does anthropology give? I'll take just 1 minute. The kind of lesson anthropology gives. The first lesson anthropology gives is, look at everything very critically. Don't base yourself on the received knowledge. Do not sit idle just because you can't do your field work. Look at what kind of alternatives you can think of. Certainly, it does not mean that the alternatives you are proposing, whether it is a culture of study of a culture at distance or other kinds of things which have come. A lot of literature is available on this, the use of the digital technology and digital ethnography and anthropology. They are not providing a viable alternative to face-to-face fieldwork. Nevertheless, they are generating important ideas which can really help us. One of the lessons of anthropology, certainly it is not the last lesson, one of the lessons of anthropology is that you have to fight the syndrome of the alien, the syndrome of what in Jharkhand is called diku, the syndrome of something who is coming from outside is going to affect you. You have to fight xenophobia, for example. You have to fight all these things, carrying forward the essential message of humanity. We are all one. It is a matter of accident that I happen to be in a family where I have come to this level. I could have been one of the migrant workers. I could have been one of the primitive tribal person. I could have been anything. This kind of a feeling for the other is something which is fundamental to anthropology. I cannot do anything better than to quote here Nancy Shepherd-Hugh. In fact, used a word which is not so much in currency, but I have liked the word, so I use it. She calls xenophilia. And by xenophilia, she means love for the other. She says, if I am not mistaken, she says that this word exists in botany for different species of plants which are together and can be explored. The concept can be further explored. Its viability can be further explored in anthropology. One of the major lessons of anthropology is place yourself in the situation of the other, then understand. Empathy is the key word which we use for this. I am grateful once again to Professor M.P. Sachdeva, my colleague, and my other colleagues with whom I stayed in the department for a long period of time. I always cherish my days in the department. I always cherish my relationship with the Department of Psychology, because when Krishwar Mishra was the head of the department, I used to teach a course on qualitative research in the department, and the result of this was one of the research students of the department decided to write a PhD, decided to read a PhD under my supervision. Today, he is one of the leading, cultural psychologists. His name is K.R. Priya, Kumar Ravi Priya, one of the excellent writers to grounded theory approach. So we look forward to more collaboration with psychology and also other department. I'm grateful to you and I wish you all the best. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Professor Srivastava, for a very comprehensive and illuminating discourse, touching upon the varied aspects of during COVID and post-COVID crises diverse societies are facing and may face in future. You have touched upon almost all the facets of anthropology and how the anthropology can contribute for the welfare of the society and particularly in facing the present crisis. I was going through the chat box and one Somnath Bhattacharji, he has written, when Professor Srivastava sir delivers lecture, it seems God has come to earth and teaching us anthropology. another great lecture from you, sir.
But this God, cannot do anything for COVID-19. God himself will suffer and can suffer.
And another comment from Ashwini is...
There was a comment I read that today God is working as a health worker.
And one comment by Ashwini is that knowledge bank of anthropological sky. It is all because of for you, sir. And thank you so much once again, Professor Srivastava.